Hello everyone, I'm going to do another tutorial today about fast global illumination approximation. Quite a mouthful. So let's dive right into Blender and I'll show you what this feature is, how to use it, and hopefully you can save yourself a bit more render time. We are using Blender 3.6 today, and this feature lives in the render properties panel. So here it is, render properties, this camera, you click that, and then I'm going to select the cycles engine because this is a feature of cycles. Scroll all the way down until we find fast global illumination approximation, which lives in the light paths tab. So you have to click light paths to make it show up. So normal global illumination in cycles is always on by default. If you go and hit F12 with any scene that has cycles set as the render engine, then you'll get, you know, usually hopefully a nice looking render, but you'll be using global illumination. And that's by simulating how the light actually bounces around in a real scene. And this can be quite costly because if you have very, very dense meshes, then that takes a lot of processing power to calculate and the simulation takes a while to solve and then you get long render times. So to help with that, Blender has got a fast global illumination approximation method that approximates it. And the way it does that is by figuring out how far away objects are from each other and then kind of just occluding things. So as you can see from this diagram, rather than actually bouncing light between these two objects, what we're doing is we're just saying because they're kind of close, light's going to find it more difficult to get in between them and therefore it will be darker. So what fast global illumination does usually is try and occlude and make things darker where objects are kind of close-ish. And that kind of fakes this sort of fall-off effect of light. So I want to show you what this actually looks like before we dive into it. I want to see if you can pick which one of these is global illumination and which one is fast global illumination approximation. Here you go. So on the left we have A and on the right we have B. And I suppose one thing you might want to think to yourself is which do you prefer? Or you might want to try and guess which one is fast global illumination. Okay, so the one on the left is global illumination, and the one on the right is kind of faking it with fast global illumination. Now the reason I want to show you these two images is because if you're happy with the image on the right, I've got good news for you, because it can actually save you quite a bit of render time. So if we look at fast global illumination, which was the image on the right, that was 1 minute 27, whereas just using cycles without it is 1 minute 44. You can see this on the graph here. So it definitely is quicker. Now let's look at, you know, how the different settings affect things. The first setting I want to look at is the number of bounces. So if we come over to the render properties panel in Blender, we can see here we've got the option to basically change how many bounces we want. And what this does is it's going to do actual path tracing up until the light rays have bounced twice, in the case of, you know, setting it to 2, and then it stops using path tracing and starts using the approximation. So first of all, I want to look at the speed. So the higher the number of bounces you allow, the slower things get. So it's going to be a bit of a balance between how does the scene look, can I do everything that I want to in post with it, and do I have a good render time. So I've just jumped into DaVinci Resolve so we can have a look at what it looks like with 1, 2, all the way up to 8 bounces, which is what we were benchmarking with. So if I pop into play mode, we can have a look at 1 bounce. The one thing you notice straight away is if you're just using the bare minimum number of bounces in path tracing and then go straight into the approximation method, it is a lot darker, and that can cause some other issues as well, which I'll demonstrate in a minute. And obviously as we increase the number of bounces, light's getting further and further into the scene until we reach 12, which is the default for the scene, and we arrive at this. So look, it's really up to you. The default is 2, so if we go down to 2 bounces, I would say this is not terrible, but the thing that might catch you out is, so if I go to 1 bounce versus 12, now we can see that there's a lot less space between this part and then the rest of the image. So what we're looking at here are luminosity values for all the pixels in a vertical strip of the image. And this part just so happens to correspond to this gray partition here, which is actually a transparent door in front of a gray wall. Now the problem we have with just 1 bounce is that these two lines are much closer, or these 3 lines actually, or this section here is really, really close and touching this section here, whereas over in the version we did with 12 bounces in path tracing, they're actually separated. It's really, really hard to actually make this image exactly like that image now, because if we're just to scale the brightness up, we'd actually pull the background up, which is not what we want. This line here is the background. So that's the difficulty if you use only one bounce. And you'll notice if we go to two bounces, it's not as bad. So that's two bounces. You can see, look, there's almost no difference between them. So my recommendation is, at least with scenes like this, two bounces seems to be enough, but you'll probably have to experiment with your scene because it probably depends on exactly what's going on. All right, so the next thing I want to look at is add versus replace. So there's a method drop-down menu here. We can choose replace, which we've just looked at, or we can choose add. First thing you'll notice is you lose access to the bounces menu. And the reason for that is Blender is using both ray tracing or path tracing and global illumination approximation together. So it will use the bounce setting that you've got here because it's doing this simulation of light for your scene, and it's using an approximation method as well. Now the first consequence of that is it's always going to be slower. At least with the scene that I was testing and all the different things that I did, it's always slower. So because it's using both methods, it will take longer to compute. And I guess it's going to be up to you whether you really like the look of it instead of just using replace or just using cycles by itself. Because it is adding extra light to the scene because it's using both methods and then using a combination of the two. I'm not exactly sure of the maths, but let's have a look at what it looks like and you can make up your own mind. So bearing in mind, anytime you see add instead of replace, it's going to be slower. So first of all, we've got what it looks like when you're just using replace. So this is two bounces and then replace everything with an approximation after that. So two bounces in cycles, path tracing, and then everything else is approximated. This is add with a blend factor of 0.1. The first thing you notice is it's a lot brighter because now we're using 12 or so bounces with cycles path tracing. And then you can just keep adding. You can use this blend factor like a color ramp. So this is full strength. And I quite like it. It adds a little bit of extra illumination. It's up to you if you prefer it. Look at your scene. It's probably worth experimenting with just to see do you like it or not, but it will be slower. This is what it looks like when it's just using path tracing and nothing else, and that's 12 bounces as well. So there you go, it's an interesting feature. If you're looking to save render time though, however, you need to use replace because this is always slower. The last setting I want to look at is AO distance, or ambient occlusion distance. What exactly is that? Well, remember that image I put up at the beginning? Ambient occlusion needs to take into consideration what objects it should use to calculate occlusion. And you can actually tune that. So you can either have objects which are only very close to you occlude, or you can choose to have a much, much bigger radius of effect so that objects very, very far away also are included in occlusion. So when it comes to performance, if you have a very, very short occlusion range, then nothing much really gets calculated because there's nothing within that radius. So imagine drawing a very tight circle around yourself in a room and saying, I'm not going to consider anything outside this tiny little circle that I'm standing in. The computer doesn't have to do much work, and therefore the time that's required for the ambient occlusion to calculate is smaller. Conversely, if you suddenly started including the entire room or the entire street or the entire city, things start to slow down a bit. Now I say a bit because usually your scene, if I go and actually look at it in Blender, if we move the camera slightly and then zoom out of it, you know, there's not really much in the known universe inside Blender. It's pretty much just the scene, that's it. We can go forever zooming out. There's nothing else. That's why we don't tend to see massive render times once we really blow out the distance setting. All right, let's look at how this actually looks. So let's jump into Resolve, we'll put the play button on, and we can look at different distances and how they look. So 10,000 down to 1,000, which is the default, you can see there's a tiny little difference. Again, if you're gonna increase the number of objects that occlude you, you're basically saying, I want more things to affect how dark things will be. That's a really, really rough approximation. So generally a larger distance setting results in a darker image. As you can see, if I go from 10,000 to 1,000, it gets a little incy-bincy bit brighter. Now, if we really go to the extreme with this, you can go a bit nuts and say, okay, only 100, and all of a sudden the scene absolutely blows out. So you have to be careful what you set this distance to and do some test rendering, because you can obviously quite clearly blow things completely sky high in terms of brightness. And of course once we're down to like 101 centimeters, there's not a huge amount of difference, because the number of objects which you include or don't include from, you know, 1 centimeter to 100 in this scene isn't actually much. Just be aware of the fact that this is in centimeters, so there is actually a unit of measurement associated with it. So if you scale models up or down, just be wary of that. So in conclusion, fast global illumination approximation, still quite a mouthful, for this scene seems like a really viable way to get down your render times. Because if we go back and look at bounces, for example, we can see that if we use cycles and just path tracing, that's a minute 44 for a frame. If we use two bounces and then global illumination approximation, it's 1 minute 27. So that's quite a saving, especially if you're doing an animation. Like, imagine an architectural fly through, that would actually help quite a lot. The other reason why I think it's actually quite nice is because we've got, again, two bounces with path tracing and then just cycles with 12. We come back, put the magnifier on, go back and look at the waveform. These waveforms are pretty nicely aligned, so it doesn't look like you're actually losing anything. If you were to use one bounce, yes, you were going to make life hard for yourself, but with two, it looks like these waveforms are almost exactly the same when you're just looking at them side by side. And certainly the images themselves are quite hard to tell apart. So yeah, good thumbs up for fast global illumination for this scene. The one thing I will say as my last parting shot is, you really do want to make sure you experiment to see where the actual optimum is for you, because it probably varies a lot depending on what features you're using of cycles, how dense your mesh is, what textures you have, HDRIs, and so on and so forth. So look, I hope this helps. If it does, please let us know. Comment down below how much render time you're able to save, if any. Or if you hit any issues, please also put them down there, because we'd like to solve those for the community. And see you later.